all the best surfers in the world come to Hawaii for that, you know, couple months period, and to get the best wave out of every single one of them, that's just so huge.
Not a day goes by in the winter, pretty much all year, where you don't hear like the words, the wave of the winter.
Every time Pike breaks, you're out there trying to get the wave of the winter. We can go out there and just surf all we want
to
surf.
To be able to win $25,000 for one wave is just like a dream.
Phantom wave that you see nobody ride and you think, oh, what if you were right in the spot? You could have made that.
Please listen carefully.
My ideal wave of the winter would be a wave that I didn't expect to make, a wave that I got to the bottom and looked up and go, oh my God, it's gonna close out.
The ideal wave of the winter for me is the latest possible drop you can take without eating it, barely getting under the lip, driving through the barrel with the biggest pumps you can possibly throw down, traveling all the way through the sandbar and coming out the end with another spit.
So you're with the chick in the barrel and you're just getting pitted over a couple foam balls, even a foam ball in front so you can't even see what we're doing. And then boom, when we come out of the barrel, I want my pants to be on my head.
A big double up, taking off on the first reef, big steep takeoff, and I guess driving into multiple sections super deep.
And just travel all the way through and come out at the Oakley House hit off the wall.
I'm paddling back out and I just barely make it in through like a second reef set. And then I end up being like somehow deeper than Wakita, which no one is, but like deeper than him, and this one comes sideways and I just happen to be in the spot. You get that easy, real west entry, and then you just come into this thing that's got like northwest in it, and you just backdoor like a 10-footer and get blown out.
What's so exciting about the wave of the winter is it really captures your imagination. And, you know, and guys go out there sort of looking at the waves maybe a little bit differently and feeling a little bit more, you know, that they can conquer anything.
And years passed before this event came to fruition, everyone had an opinion of whose wave was that wave of the winter.
Anyone can win. I mean, all they have to do is catch that great wave and get a great ride. And I think that's really the beauty of it.
I mean, everyone knows about Pipeline. It's, you know, the biggest wonder in the world as far as waves are concerned.
North Shore's just got this raw energy that really produces drama.
The North Shore being the epicenter of the surfing world and having the waves that we do on tap here all winter, it just has really allowed the performance levels to elevate, specifically out at Pipeline and Backdoor and off the wall.
Just that 150 yards of reef produces easily the most exciting barrels on the North Shore every year. That's gonna happen no matter what.
Just the power and the energy of that wave has, it's addicting, and I think a lot of guys just, you know, that's what they're, when they come to the North Shore, that's what they're looking for. They're looking for the wave of their life.
It's hard to describe an ideal wave of the winter and after you've won it already. So, I mean, that wave when I caught it, you know, I didn't think it was gonna be the winner, but it ended up being the winner, and all of a sudden you get a big check. I'm the same person and I'm still right here. It's not like I retired and gave up on surfing.
You know, it changed my life a lot, you know, winning 25 grand, and that was actually one of the best years of my life all around. Like, I think I won that wave of the winter and then got second in the shootout and a couple other things, and it all fell into place for me.
I changed a lot, man. Changed like my whole life, probably. It's good to be the one for a moment, you know.
When Reef won his wave of the winter, that seemed like kind of one of those random waves that it could have been amazing or it could have just been horrific, and and it ended up being amazing. You rode it perfectly. So that's what I, when I think of the wave of the winter, that's what I think of, you know, just the craziest wave, and chaos turns into total bliss. People love the water, not the people love the sun. Everybody got a job to run and getting a job done. What are you doing for them? Some jump families are for everyone. Over there for back.
November is always a strange month. You know, you can either get a couple really good swells, but still a lot of sand. You know, the winter's not in tune yet.
First couple days of Triple Crown, that was kind of a unique swell. That it was driven a lot by this big high that was north of Hawaii.
We saw John getting a couple phenomenal waves at Pupukea, and then, you know, eventually we started seeing a lot of variable days, a lot of swells that kind of more out of that west northwest angle, and that really opened up Pipe and Back Door.
Black Friday swell. Was it, you know, the day after Thanksgiving, and at that point is probably the biggest northwest swell of the season. Solid, great condition. Like, we had southeasterly winds on that Friday, which Pipe loves. Sunset was going off for the contest. At that point anyway, it's probably the day of the year at Pipe.
When we're all sinners, loops and all cruising, raw space crashing in, the walls are closing in, on Wall Street they cashing in, breaking in, they're working all they like to see the other end.
You got Ross Williams, you got Pancho Sullivan, you got the master, Jerry Lopez, and basically, you know, those guys like the technical side of things. I think Jerry likes the styled out kind of things. You know, I like technical surfing at Pipeline, and I would assume Jerry Lopez likes stylish surfing at Pipeline.
You know, Jerry hardly puts any time in at Pipeline anymore, but he probably knows it more intimately than anybody after all those years of having it, you know, with so few people out back in the 70s and into the 80s. Pancho, he's a really technical surfer, and, you know, he's been out here his whole life too, so those guys know what they're talking about, you know?
Between Jerry, Pancho, and myself, we take it very serious, and it's exciting to do, but at the same time, it's stressful because you want to make the right decision because these guys are really good, and there's a lot at stake.
It's an amazing spectating view. Look how close people are. Look how you can, like, feel the energy of the wave. Even if you're sitting on the couch in the house and you hear everyone, woo, like, you're like, whoa, what happened? Or who got a good wave?
You have all these houses, all these people from all over the world. They all want to get the best wave of their life, or wave of the winter, or GoPro of the winter. It's like a contest every free surf now.
It's very competitive. Everyone's trying to get the shot, everyone's trying to get the clip.
Everyone's trying to fight to get that one good wave, and hundreds of people out, small lineup, it's like pretty hectic.
Guys are sitting outside, guys are sitting underneath, guys are sitting wide, guys are getting washed down to rocky, so it's kind of, the lineup is in flux constantly. It's moving. It's like alive out there.
Somewhat of a pecking order out there, but it's the familiar faces, and there's a lot of guys who want it. It's insane to sit there on the beach and watch, you know, after 30 years of going there. It's still as exciting as day one, pretty much.
It's always been like that right here. From them surfing it back in the day to what it is now, it's the big stage.
Every great wave you most likely see, you'll see the boil. And basically, it's just a long finger reef with a scoop at the end, and it pushes all this water up. I mean, I've took some crazy wipeouts on that boil. You don't want to be in the middle of that boil, or you don't want to be paddling in front of the boil, because it'll throw your board off your chest, and then you're screwed.
You want to be behind the boil. When it's doing its boil, you know that one's really freaking some a lot of water sucking up.
The boil I use a lot, actually, especially if I paddle out dark, usually. But sometimes you think, you kind of don't even think about the boil, and you paddle, and you try and paddle straight through the boil, and you just, you're blown.
Sometimes the ones more down towards the end, you know, you take off after the boil, and you get barreled all the way through Ehukai.
If you see the wave starting to barrel where the boil is, you know it's a big wave. Because generally, the you know, anything under 8 feet moves inside of that. Anything over 8 feet will start to barrel like as it's at the boil already. That's where all the good waves come, and that's where you got to figure out how to be. You know, pipeline sort of holds a lot of people's best and worst memories from surfing. You know, a lot of injuries, a lot of bad wipeouts, but you know, that comes with the territory when you're looking for the best wave you can get.
You're always kind of getting rolled over the reef, and it's sharp, you know, it can be barnacles and stuff like that on it and cut you up.
On the inside, to me, is almost the most dangerous part of the whole entire thing, at least the inside left. It has like these really sharp, jagged edges and like these really uneven pieces of reef. They're like almost like arms sticking up, like just big old like chunks of reef that you don't want to hit. I've seen people break their fins out in barrels, you know, at pipe and back door. It's all dangerous, and it's all it deserves its respect, you know, all of it.
If it wasn't for our North Shore lifeguards, you know, all the boys in the tower at pipe, you know, they're awesome. I mean, the consequences, you know, I've ripped off my kneecap, I've broke my ribs, I've cracked my head, I've stitches, I mean, you name it, I've hit the reef at pipe, and, you know, those guys were always there to take care of me.
I think the cave thing is a little overrated at pipeline. Knock on wood.
Nowadays, they figured it out, you know, they'll go out there in the summertime with a faceplate and dive that whole area so they know what they're surfing over, and they know if they eat it on the drop that they could get stuffed down into that cave, that, you know, that big crack there that makes the boil right there at the takeoff spot. I was stuffed into that more than a few times.
I think the number one reason why all the past winners have been right here in this little 50-yard stretch is because obviously the way the reef shape and the way the swell comes in.
All those storms that are in the off Japan and in the central North Pacific are all aiming energy right down towards the North Shore and just catching it with that catcher's mitt. And with Hawaii, there's no continental shelf, so you know, all that open ocean power is able to hit the islands intact. So no slowing down of those waves, no weakening of those waves. And you've got a series of these outer reefs offshore, so outer log cabins being kind of the primary one, which helps to suck in any longer period energy, especially, you know, swell periods of 16 seconds or greater, really helps to suck in that energy. And as you start to see the transitioning swell directions and swell period, you can start to see those waves shift up and down the reef, whether it's, you know, focusing a pipe or focusing it off the wall or back door, whatever it happens to be. The other thing is the prevailing winds, which are trades, easterly trades, are offshore or side offshore for the majority of the breaks on the North Shore. So you've got large consistent surf, you have good local conditions, the result is quality surf pretty much all winter long.
I'd say this is the best December in 15 years.
You know, that December was just all time. It was an intense few weeks or even month. It was like just nonstop, and they were just scooping off the reef and just straight trade winds right into the barrel, and you had to like be on your toes. Guys were getting hurt. It was no joke.
Every day, it's one of those months where you're like, God, it's 10 feet again. 10 feet again, is there'd be so many second reef like cleanup sets, but in between there was like these perfect 10, 12 footers, and it was hard work, and you know, your cardio level that month just went skyrocketing.
So to have that southeast wind combined with a 10 to 12 foot swell at pipe to not only happen once, but three or four or five times is crazy on a North Shore. And so there is a lot of buzz, a lot of people talking about the best winter in, you know, many, many years.
Tori Meister's backdoor one is pretty epic.
The best way is a backdoor, usually around the first reef. And I was kind of in between, and I just try to paddle as hard as I could, and I remember like taking my bottom turn and looking up, and it was just so big, and I remember kind of looking at it for a second, and then it just kind of went white. It just spit really hard, and I couldn't really see what was going on, and then all of a sudden I came out, and I was like, whoa, that was cool. It's definitely going to be one of the memorable ones for me forever.
You know, you never knew until the morning you woke up that's how good the waves were.
Jamie O'Brien's wave from the early morning session with his wetsuit on, it was incredible.
Yeah, I remember that particular wave. I paddled out pretty early. I was like, you know, that was one of my first waves. And I remember dropping in going, oh my God, I'm deep. And I was just like, oh well, I'm just gonna do the biggest pump I could. And I was like, there was no enjoying it. It was like, pedal to the metal, you gotta make this wave or you're gonna get smoked. And I remember getting to one stage and I was like, oh, this thing's gonna back breathe. And when I'm talking about back breathe, it's the opposite feeling of spit going forward. It sucks you back, so it actually starts slowing you down, and then like, and you're like, oh, when's it gonna stop? And it's like stinging your face, and then it just starts spitting, and it just, next thing you know, you're going twice as fast than you were going in the beginning. And I saw one line and I just picked my line and I came out and I kind of claimed it hard. I was just stoked. That's what surfing's about.
The swell that hit around the 20th and 21st was really, really west. You know, I think there was energy all the way down to like 285, 290 degrees, you know, like that 8 at 17 on the nearshore buoys, and just sunny skies, light trades, which that's pretty rare.
Reef's wave was really big. I thought it was a really big pipe wave, and the way he rode it was really, really cool. It was long barrel and it was really big. And
that one came in, I knew I was deep, and I just went and threaded the needle. And that was it, pretty much. I went in, had a beer.
And then obviously Kelly's wave was insane. I think the way he rode it, I don't think anyone else in the world could have done that. It was out of control. It was beyond, you know, human.
Yeah, it was right on the winter solstice on December 21st. Shortest day of the year, but probably the best day of the year for waves. Basically every single set had three plus good waves in it that were like, you know, at least 6 feet, maybe 8 feet, and then up to 10 foot plus. But it was all shelfing in the same spot every time, so you weren't playing that game like, do I go deep, do I go wide, where's it gonna be? It was like pretty much all just cornering right on the boil. And I can't tell you how many guys I saw get crazy waves that day.
It's hard to not appreciate every single wave that was entered on December 21st. Almost every time you open an entry from that day, it just pops. You know, the waves were bright blue, it was just crystal offshore wind. It was just pristine. And that's when you see these waves light up.
To catch pipeline, you know, 8 to 10, 12 foot, and perfect, it's what surfing's made of. It's what you draw in your book at school, it's all that stuff. And you know, December just had some pumping waves, man.
Oh, the anticipation of big sets coming when you're sitting right where you want to sit is probably the best feeling in the whole world. I was in there, I was like, yeah, I got a chance, and I just held that rail as hard as I could, and it like, I just felt it spit, and I felt my board lift up. It did like a full lift up. I felt it go sideways and do a little cuckoo like catch, and then but I got to ride out and I was just so happy.
The end of December was, you know, good solid swell and just phenomenal wind conditions, and it's pretty special to get pipe to be that good on consecutive days is pretty rare.
It makes not only the surfing good for Wave of the Winter, but when you have a wave that looks that crazy and thick with clean conditions, it makes it nice to look at.
When I was like taking off, I finally looked down the line, I was already like barreling, and I was like, oh no, I'm way too late. And I knew I couldn't go all the way to the bottom, so I had to knife it halfway up, and then lucky I got a good pump in. Usually those ones go really flat and just pinch, but this one just bowled out really nice, so super lucky.
For GoPro the winner, guys like Kamale and Anthony and Stefan and Kalani, everybody helped push the level to where it's at.
was a perfect little backdoor day. I mean, it was like 6 feet, but I remember paddling in, I was real glassy, real clean, and I was looking at it like, oh, this is a perfect one, and I locked in, and I was in the barrel, and I was like, deep.
January, there was a couple of good big swells, but there was some north wind.
January was the worst January I've seen in my life. You know, I figure the good and then the bad.
Like those December swells, like every set was good. January, you kind of really had to go out there and like needle in a haystack, like hunt it down, try find one. And there wasn't a lot, but there definitely was some entries.
This wave popped up. It didn't seem to be that incredible. It kind of gave me a nice in. And next thing I knew, I was kind of like way behind the peak. So I really drew my bottom turn out and drove up into it. It was a pretty wild experience when I was inside the barrel. It was like, it was just spitting and I couldn't see anything. And then when I came out, I was like pretty shocked actually.
I thought that wave was phenomenal. I mean, I didn't really know who he was. And you know, to see him commit to a wave like that and be as deep as he was, and you know, basically come out after the spit, I was really impressed.
My muse are the hues of the night skies, fused with a bright face, young nieces holding hands and walking on my right hip. Lifetime journeys in the backyard, journey all in, all grins down the pipeline. Serve it when I'm nervous, it's the same as when I'm confident. Prefer it on the curb opposed to being on the upper deck. Not quite, that pedestal can crack. You inspire me and I inspire you.
When the rain has come. Then that massive swirl came. The winds were not the best over here, but it was awesome just to watch the pure energy of the ocean. It was like intense just to even be on land.
We saw, you know, some great days of surfing, but we saw much more of a typical, you know, characteristics from the North Shore, where the wind got a little more rough, some huge swells which sort of washed the sand around too much, unlike December where everyone was just raising their hands in the air and just sitting there in perfect tubes.
Into and through most of February, there's a lot of rain on the North Shore. The winds were kind of variable and just all over the place, but there were moments where they would get pretty good at backdoor off the wall and, or pipe, and there were some big days too.
Kelly Slater's wave during the Vulcan Pro to me was one of the craziest waves I've seen ever at pipe. I mean, I think almost every single human on this planet would have just cannonballed and fell out of the sky. And somehow he just knifed it and got under the lip just in time, meanwhile with no hands. I mean, just a complete freak.
Kelly Slater makes the drop. Pipe barrel, yes!
Wow.
Obviously, Mother Nature is pretty unpredictable, and you know the conditions really inevitably is the determining factor with this event. If you don't get those waves when it's, you know, when it's on, then you're obviously gonna miss out on the opportunity. And I think, you know, there was clearly a group of guys that were really committed and devoted to being out at pipe and backdoor and off the wall when it was on, because there was consistent entries from each of those days from, I would say, a group of about 10 guys. Consistently you saw, whether it was a wave at pipe or it was a wave at backdoor or off the wall, they were consistently in the mix.
There was a ton of guys that didn't even make the top 10 that were incredible, and they had a handful of waves. Kieran Jabor, he had like 3 or 4 waves this year that were incredible. I thought Nat Young, he had one of the deepest barrels all year. You know, it wasn't the biggest wave, but it was so late and deep, came out way after the spit, and that was early on in the season.
Every year Reef's gonna be in the mix because he puts in so much time and he knows the wave so good and he charges, and you know, he just knows how to ride a barrel. He's not intimidated by pipeline.
There's no entry that's like, oh my God, that's it. There's a lot of ones that are like, sheesh. We're gonna have to really freaking pick these apart.
It was like mind-bending going through all the footage and trying to, you know, really split hairs between one ride and,
and another. I mean, really, I think this was a much harder year because there were so many similar rides. You really had to like slow it down and dissect how late was the takeoff, how deep was the guy in the barrel, was he dragging, did he backdoor the section? I mean, I think we all felt like it was a little bit more difficult to really decipher because there were so many great entries.
I mean, you can't just like whip through it and go, oh yeah, these are 10. And these guys are like kind of counting on you to, you know, choose the right ones. And so, you know, you're constantly juggling these rides and looking at them and going over them time and time again to try and, okay, you know, I got to come up with 10 for this month.
There was at least, in my opinion, 30 to 40 amazing rides this winter. And there really wasn't an extreme difference between them all. They were, you know, the winner was this much better.
When the results came out, we were all pretty close. So I guess we're kind of all seeing the same thing.
Bet you weren't expecting this one either. You were expecting that one?
No!
Wave of the winner, too!
No way! Are you serious?
Congrats! Oh, man, little strike, no. Double here. Yeah.
What?
Yeah. Oh, he's surprised you.
Oh, you
lovely
bastard.
Chrissy to present it to you.
Thank you.
No way!
Run.
I was like, what the hell is going on here? All these people.
Wave of the winner. That's such a surprise. I knew I had a couple good ones, but I spent a lot of time in the moment at Pipeline this year, and it paid off. I definitely had my best year at Pipeline in many years, maybe ever. You know, I was able to probably get, you know, 5 or 10 memorable waves. Yeah, it came in. It just was kind of feathering a little bit on the second reef, not quite on second reef, but kind of in between first and second, like standing up. I didn't really have a choice to grab the rail. I was kind of contorted trying to get under it. You know, I had to turn really quick. And I pulled up. I was trying to figure out which line I was going to take. And I saw the foam ball coming up to kind of hit me. And I literally got ready to jump. I kind of put my weight up like this in the barrel. I remember kind of lifting up, going, okay, I'll jump and try to get away from my board as soon as it blasts me. But somehow it kind of lifted my tail up and pushed my board up into my feet and just threw me out of the barrel. And I was really surprised I made it, you know. To me, that was definitely one of the best rides I've ever had at Pipeline.
It was probably touch and go for him, yeah, coming out of that tube. And all of us went, yeah, that one took a little extra to make.
When we decided on Kelly Slater winning the wave of the winter, my instinct was like, okay, let's share the wealth a little bit and maybe pass the performer of the year to someone else, but we just simply couldn't do it because you couldn't argue the fact that Kelly just absolutely dominated.
Kelly was just consistently on it. You know, obviously winning the Pipe Masters, winning the Volcom event, you know, and then taking out the wave of the winter. But he has a knack for finding those waves and reading them better than anybody. You know, that was incredible to pull in and be that deep, backhand, not grabbing the rail. You know, is just the ultimate testament of how skilled he is out there.
You know, there's a long history of waves of the winter, so I think this event is going to be around for a long time, and it means a lot to the surfers.
Our sport continues to evolve, and you see, you know, guys surfing at a higher and higher level that you never thought was possible. And I think, you know, all of these guys that had entries into this year's event are sort of a part of that evolution of the surfing, not just at Pipeline, but in general, just pushing the boundaries of what's possible.
And then boom, when we come out of the barrel, act like you're coming in and just whoo, Johnny Boy hard kick out, boom, and then paddle right all the way back out, like through Pupukea, like so no one could talk to you, like you just got it to yourself, just like, uh-huh, wave of the winter, mother.
I'm still drunk from the night before. All these chicks will look like models once. shots, I'll finish off this bottle. The cops are knocking at my door, but I'm still drunk from the night before. Now what the hell is going on? Who parked the car out on the lawn? Oh well, at least we made it home. My bar receipts a mile long, my wallet and my phone are gone. Looks like I got a ways to go. Finish off this bottle. And the cops are knocking at my door, but I'm still drunk from the night before. And now it's crystal clear. What started out with just a beer turned into shots of tequila. And I was Mr. Nice to Meet Ya. Barely made it out the bar. Hitchhiked down that boulevard. I think I met my future wife, but I forgot what she looks like. I fell in love, fell down the stairs. Can't remember much from there, but I know there'll be plenty more times I'm drunk from the night before. So what? It doesn't matter, 'cause I know that once I hit the ocean, I'll be alright. The waves will wash this hangover away, 'cause we're still drunk from the night before. All these chicks will look like models once I finish off this bottle.